God bless your family.
That will never change.
God bless you.
He is good. His mercy and his truth endures.
Come on in. Hallelujah. God is worthy to be praised. Mr. Williams, God bless you. Miss Green, God bless you, Miss Green. Hallelujah. 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 Miss Jackson, Miss Brinkley, Uncle Richard, Kay, God bless you. Come on. Miss King, God bless you. God is worthy, family. God is worthy to be praised. Listen, so nobody won't forget to share it. Everybody share it. So nobody won't forget to share it. Everybody like and share. Hallelujah. Right now, everybody like and share. Hallelujah. Shatar, God bless you. Sister Tracy, God bless you. Hallelujah. Everybody share. Miss Few, God bless you. God bless Miss King for sharing. Kay for sharing. Hallelujah. Miss Green for sharing. Ariel, what's going on? God bless you. Val, what's going on? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, family. Share. Ms. Lazenby. God bless you. Come on. If you know. Hallelujah. Get your Bibles, family. Let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 12. Let me invite some people on. People are not sharing. Sister Janice have not shared. Mr. Williams shared, hasn't shared. Let's go. Let's just see. Let's see. Val, we thank you for sharing. Hallelujah. It take you 1 second to share. Shatar has shared. Hallelujah. God bless those that have already shared. May God multiply your hands in Jesus' name. Those who already have shared, may God move upon you. May the blessing locate you this week for those that who have already shared. May a blessing locate you this week in Jesus' name. So those of you that shared, receive that. Miss Jackson, God bless you. Mr. Avery, God bless you. Mr. Stalworth, God bless you. Hallelujah. Come on. Kim, come on. God bless you. Acts chapter 12, family. Hallelujah. I'm going to say something, family. Come on. Hallelujah. Let me see. Sister Janice, you hadn't shared, have you? Okay. We see you done shared. Come on. Val, we thank you for sharing. Mr. Williams. Hallelujah. Miss Lazenby, thank God for your sharing. Hallelujah. God is worthy. So, there's a problem, family. When you want the word. Hallelujah. When you want the word, expect what you prayed for. Expect what you prayed for. Hallelujah. Expect what you pray for. Acts chapter 12. Hallelujah. Mr. West. Mr. John. Come on, let me know where you're tuning in from, family. Let me know where you're tuning in from. Come on, let me know where you're tuning in from. God bless you, Ty. It's Whitfield. Let me know where you're tuning in from, family. And then send the fire after you let me know where you're tuning in from. Glory God. So listen, we had an amazing time at church. God showed up, showed out. We give God all the glory, the honor, and the praise. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 12, we're going to pray. We're going to go dead into the word. Listen, you prayed for it. And we want to take you through the scripture to show you what you prayed for. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your grace, your mercy, your love and kindness. We thank you for being God and being God all by yourself. Besides you, there is no other. Father, saturate this life under your blood. Father, cover me. Hallelujah. Father, right now with your presence, Father, saturate me with your wisdom, knowledge, and understanding of your word. Father, cover the life. Father, put a hedge of fire around it. Put angels on assignment. We come up against every plot plan of the enemy, every distraction right now in the name of Jesus. We bind it, we render it powerless, we release the presence of God upon the life, that healing take place, that deliverance take place, that miracle signs and wonders take place, that this is a right now word. Father, in the name of Jesus, give us this day our daily bread, Father, right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we decree and declare it done in your son Jesus' name. Come on, let the church say amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah, come on. Hallelujah. Come on. Acts chapter 12. If you got it, say, I got it. Everybody should share. Sharing is caring. It's a problem when you don't share. When he told us to be fruitful and multiply, it's not going to take away from you getting the word of God. But we're supposed to reach the multitude together. And it's a problem when only one person is pulling and the other people are watching. That's a problem. How can we see one person pull and we don't help push the ministry down the road? Every one of you should have shared, period, point blank. No exceptions to the rule. No exception to the rule. Everybody should share. That's what you should do. It's only right. because sharing is caring. When somebody is on the line, somebody, your timeline is somebody's lifeline. And you willing to share stuff that don't make sense on your timeline. But when it comes to a true word of God, we hesitate to share the word of God. But you quick to share people you don't even know. And then when they hand get exposed and they're not who they say they are, your page is full of their stuff. But somebody that can pray for you, pray with you, speak over your life, miracle signs and wonders take place. How dare you not want to share? Where in the world do you get your manners from? The Bible said, receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, and immediately you get a prophet's reward. You can't make my name great, but I'm trying to reach your family. I'm trying to reach your friends. I'm trying to reach your children. I'm trying to reach your sister, your brother, your nieces, your nephews. Because if the enemy have his way with them, you'll be crying. But we don't want to share. We share all this other stuff. That's crazy. If you want somebody to speak a word over you, I'm going to speak a word. Learn how to be obedient to the word. He said, be fruitful and multiply. We supposed to share the good news. Hallelujah. Yes. I don't know what people get it from. They just, it irritates me. Because if you inbox me or you call me and you need me, but then you don't want it on your page, then I'm not going, ain't nothing I can do for you. I let you, whoever you sharing on your page, let them pray for you and see what happened. And then when you come back, you'll respect the oil enough that say, I'm going to share. Because sharing is caring. People life on the line, and you sit back and like, well, I ain't going to share. I'm just going to listen. We don't want people who just sitting on the line listening. Closed mouth never get fed. Exactly. They didn't learn how to be obedient to the word. They don't want to be obedient to the word. They just want a quick fix, and it's the wrong place. Bingo. That's right. It's selfish. Come on now. You feel me, Uncle Richard? You feel me? I understand, Uncle Richard, but we're going to go on. I mean, listen, y'all ready to eat, put the plate in the silverware up? Come on now, you feel me? What is that guy's name? Hold on, family. Come on. Send the fire. It's one guy that the Lord just laid in my spirit to put on the line. Hallelujah. He must need this word. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, he's worthy. Come on, sharing is caring. I'm telling you, we're here to blow your mind tonight. We're going to see what the Spirit has to say to the church tonight. Now listen, family, Acts chapter 12, verse number 1. Now, you need to expect what you pray for. When you live in a life that's pleasing to God, you need to expect what you pray for. The problem is, the Bible said, watch well as pray and pray well as watch. That means when I pray, I need to watch for what I pray for. Hallelujah. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Listen, let me help you. There's no way around ignorance. The Bible says he would not have us ignorant. Ignorant is you hear somebody saying it and telling you, and then you refuse to do something different. Come on, I'm going to do something else. You refuse to do what they saying. You want to do what you want to do. That is not a move of God. That's a move of flesh. And as long as you in your flesh, you'll never get to the end of your flesh. You'll never get to the beginning of God. Because God is not in your flesh. He said, deny yourself and follow. If you can't get one assignment right, what are you, Nicodemus? What are you, Nicodemus? You got to come by night. No, get saved for real. Let people know you want the word for real. Quit playing these games. I'm not looking for 30 people on here. I'm not looking for 50 people on here. If I can get 12 faithful people, we can take this thing to another level. So it ain't about numbers. People will tell you that with me. It ain't about numbers. If you don't want to share, then just watch out. Let somebody come in here and sit down that want to eat. Listen, Joanna Tardy, I don't know where you came from or whatever. Listen, I don't know if you read the Bible or whatever the case may be, or whatever the case may be, or who your leader is. But listen, I don't know. I'll take you through the word if you need to go through the word. But the Bible says receive a prophet in the name of a prophet. You get a prophet reward. How can you receive something unless you open up and let it in? That's why Jesus, when he spoke, when Moses spoke to Pharaoh, his heart was hardened. So no matter how many times he spoke to him, he couldn't get through to him. Now, let me teach you the Bible since this. Let's go to the Bible. Because it's a man in the Bible that wasted his seeds on the ground. And God said, because the man wasted seed on the ground, God said, I'm going to kill him. Hallelujah. Trust me, I didn't just start this today. This is the word. I didn't just wake up today. This is the word. I'm telling you, somebody on your timeline needs to hear this. I promise you. Anyway, I tell you what, we'll get to it. Let this go. I'm telling you, family, if you believe, you receive. If you doubt, you do without. That's just how it goes. Now, we are in the book of Acts, chapter 12. I don't move. Big numbers don't impress me when people ain't saved. People on this live already know. Let me just do a roll check. How many people know that I hear from God? And if God tell me something, I speak and you'll see what God told me. If you know, say I know. So I want to teach the people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me help you. They ain't doing this just cause I just popped up overnight. If I tell you, you best to believe it's getting ready to happen. Hallelujah. It's getting ready to happen. I got a testimony book right here somewhere. If I tell you, it's getting ready to happen. Hallelujah. So let's go on, family. Sharing is caring. If you come on, make sure you share it to your page. Simple. That ain't going to hurt you. Acts chapter 12. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hand to vex a certain of the church. To vex, come on, certain part of the church. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to do something to the church. The church. Thank you for sharing, Ms. William. The church. The enemy is after the church. And if the church has their own way of doing stuff instead of the way that God has to do stuff, then you will continue to walk out the will of God thinking you in the will of God. He said, many will say, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out devils in your name? Didn't we lay hands on the sick in your name? He said, yeah, depart from me. I know you not, you workers of iniquity. What good is you reading the Bible, but you won't live what you're reading? Lucifer knew the word. And when he got knocked out of heaven, he took what he knew with it. And he met Jesus in the wilderness and tried him with the word. The problem with the church is you read the word. You go to church, but you won't read. You won't live the word that you're reading. So you have no manifestation. So you have no presence because you're not willing to apply the word. Write that down. Put apply the word. Write that down. Put apply the word. Apply the word. If the word say be holy, be holy. If the word say obey them that have ruler over you, he's not just talking about your mama and your daddy. It's ranks in the spirit. There are ranks. You cannot just read the word and never apply the word. Then the Bible says it's better not to know than to know anyway. You got to apply the word that you get. The only shepherd that don't care what he feed his sheep is a shepherd that's a wolf in sheep clothing. If you know a shepherd has a rod and a staff, and both of them is for correction. Clear what's going on, buddy. And both of them is for correction. There's a rod and a staff that the shepherd has. He corrects the sheep. He don't let the sheep go astray. Now, we're in the book of Acts chapter 12. Now, watch it. Herod trying to vex the church, a certain part of the church. He's trying to vex a certain part of the church. Verse 2. And he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. What part of the church is Herod trying to vex? He's trying to vex the disciples that were with Jesus. It said that he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. So the only reason he's killing a Christian is because it pleased people. It pleased people. Yes, shepherds correct the sheep. They don't let the sheep go astray. They lead them in the right way. Watch this. Then there was the day of unleavened bread. Verse number 4. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison. When the king had Peter apprehended, he threw Peter in prison. So you ain't ready for this word until you ready to die to your flesh so your spirit can live. Jesus said, deny yourself and follow me. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, for that's your reasonable service. If you are not willing to present your body a living sacrifice, then I'm not speaking to you. But those that are willing to present their body a living sacrifice, you got to expect what you prayed for. You have to expect what you prayed for. Let me help you out. We getting there. And the Bible said, when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to the four coordinations of the soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring forth to the people. So they done locked Peter up. They killed James. Right? They killed James. They locked Peter up and said, we're going to bring him out after Easter, to bring him forth to the people. Because remember, in the upper verse, it said that it pleased the people when he killed James, the brother of John, with his sword. He saw that it pleased the Jews. What's going on, Nisha? Watch this. Verse number 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison. Watch this. But prayers was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Peter is in prison. As Peter is in prison, the church does not stop praying for Peter. The church begins to pray for Peter outside, lifting Peter up before God. Why? Because prayer changed things. Come on, write that down. Prayer changed things. So they begin to start a prayer meeting for Peter. Let me read it again. Verse number 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayers were made without seasoning of the church unto God for him. That means Peter, it was some people that knew Peter was in there wrongfully, but they wanted Peter out. And I'm here to tell you today, some of your family, the enemy got them in a place and you want them out. The only way they coming out is prayer. The enemy got your family in the streets. The only way they coming out is prayer. Prayer changes things. If you are not willing to pray, no need of expecting what you never prayed for. You got to expect what you prayed for. All right. So Peter was in prison. But while he was in prison, the people said, we cannot allow the enemy to steal Peter, our leader. We cannot allow the enemy to steal our leader. So the people came together and said, we're going to go and do what he taught us to do. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. We're going to pray without ceasing. We're going to keep praying until God hears us and deliver Peter out of the situation that he is in. I don't know who I'm talking to. Some of you, you pray one time and then you don't see what you prayed for, but you got to keep praying. You got to pray without seasoning. Yes, he heard you the first time, but you need to pray until you see what you're praying for. It has to come into manifestation. Watch this. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, right? But prayer was made without seasoning. Without seasoning. Come on. Of the church. The prayers were made of the church. And as the prayers were made of the church, something has to happen when the church come together. Something has to happen when the church comes together. When the true church comes together in prayer, it's supposed to shake something. Something is getting ready to happen. The Bible said, the prayers of the righteous availeth much. The church is praying for Peter. Peter is in prison. The church is outside of prison. But when you begin to make intercession for somebody that's in a locked up situation, and if you keep praying long enough and hard enough, you'll see. You right? We see it happening every day, every Sunday. Somebody getting set free, somebody getting delivered, somebody getting healed. We see it. We see it every Sunday. We see it. We see it. We see miracles, signs, and wonders. We see it happen. Peter is locked up and can't let himself out. But just because he's in a bad situation, the church is making intercession for Peter. Some of your children have went astray. How much intercession have you made for your children? Some of your family are on a bed of affliction. How many times have you prayed for them? until you see what you prayed for, you never stop praying. I need everybody to say, never stop praying. Until you see what you prayed for, you never stop praying. You never stop praying. I was talking to my uncle earlier this week. We were talking about a situation with a young man. And I told him, he said, everything is, he's doing better than what he was when we first start praying. I told him, we will not stop praying. He's on here right now. I said, we will not stop praying until he has a full, speedy recovery. You never stop praying until you see what you prayed for. Peter was kept in prison. And the church was praying without ceasing. Peter was in a situation. And the church was praying for Peter. My question to you, who are you praying for? And how long are you praying? Come on. Watch this now. They're right. They connection. If their connection can't be good, Uncle Richard. If when they pray, they can't get a manifestation of God. If you telling me you love God and God is with you and he hears your prayers, when you get real serious and you start praying, he's going to show up. So let's go further. Verse number 6. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. They had Peter in the midst of the prison. They wanted to make sure that nobody got Peter out. They wanted to make sure that Peter stayed in that situation. The enemy had Peter locked up. But the true saints was on the outside making a prayer request made known to God. They were praying. When Peter could not get himself out, the church was praying to bring Peter out. My question to you is, how long are you going to see your family in that situation and not start to make sacrifices and prayers and lay on your face and fast and pray until you see your family come out of that mess that they're in? Peter was sleeping. The Bible said that the church was praying without ceasing. Expect what you prayed for. Peter was inside sleeping. The church is up on the watch. And they're making prayers without ceasing. They're not stopping. They keep praying. Because they know prayer changes things. Yes, James will kill, but if we keep praying hard enough, God will deliver Peter. Watch this. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keeper before the devil kept the prison. They got it chained up, making sure Peter don't go nowhere. They have him chained up, but they got two soldiers around him and they got a guard at the door, making sure Peter don't get away. And some of you, that's how the enemy has your family. That's how the enemy has your finances, is making sure your finances are in prison. And the enemy has your finances bound up, making sure that you stay in poverty, making sure that you stay in lack, making sure. Because you won't pray. You say a little prayer, but you won't pray without ceasing. You don't want to live holy. You want to do what you want to do when you need a shepherd and the shepherd tend to the sheep. Jesus tells his disciple Peter, he said, Peter, if you love me, feed my sheep. He said, Peter, if you love me, feed my lamb. Then he told him again, Peter, if you love me, feed my sheep. He told him three times. He told Peter to feed him. That meant Peter was to tend to him. And not feed his sheep, Jesus' sheep, what he wanted. He had to get a word from Jesus to give to the sheep, called their daily bread. Watch this. So when your money get funny, the enemy is trying to tie your money up in prison. Lock it up so your funds cannot be released. Lock it up so your family can stay on drugs. Lock it up so they can stay as an alcoholic. Lock it up so they can stay in homosexuality. Lock it up so they can stay in prison. Lock it up. The enemy knows that the church don't really want to pray like the old church did. They want to make one prayer and figure that's it and that'll do it. But it says that they were praying without ceasing. They did not stop praying. And the moment you stop praying, you become the prey. Peter is asleep. Peter is asleep. But the church is on the watch praying for Peter. How many times have you prayed for your leader? How many times have you prayed for your family? How many times have you prayed for your situation? Don't just get in trouble and want to pray. You got to create a prayer life. And if you don't have a prayer life, you're only going to pray when you're in trouble. And if you pray only when you're in trouble, you already in trouble. So the church is making prayers. Peter is inside the prison, sleep. Let me help you. He's sleeping between two soldiers, bound with chains. But the keeper before the door, it's keepers before the door. I want y'all to see that. We're in verse number 6, Acts 12 and 6. Watch this. It was keepers before the door kept the prison. Come on. It was keepers before the door that kept the prison. So not only do Peter has two people beside him, this is why your prayers cannot stop. Because Peter got two beside him, but he also has two, got a couple of in front of him inside the, in front of the gate, making sure that we don't lose Peter. And the enemy takes your family, takes your friends, takes your situation, takes things that matter to you and lock it up in prison and hold it from you. And because you won't pray enough, you pray a little bit, but it cannot be, you're not praying enough to get it to break. Watch this. Verse number 7. And behold, the angel of the Lord came unto him, and light shined in the prison. The prayers were being made without ceasing by the church. But the Bible says that a light. Behold, the angel of the Lord came unto him, and a light shined in the prison. Oh yeah, most definitely. Sin is your corrosion in your prayer connection to God. Now watch this. The angel of the Lord came to Peter. Peter is asleep. The church is praying. And the angel of the Lord hears the church and he comes to Peter and shines a light upon him. Now watch this. And a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side. Pow. The angel went in and got what the church was praying for. Let me help you out. I said the angel went in and got what the church was praying for. Let me help you out. Smote Peter on the side and said, "Rise up, arise, quickly. When Peter looked and rose up quickly, it said his chains fell off from his hands. Two chains had him tied. But when the angel smote him, the chains, chains. When he got up, the chains fell off. I feel that some of you need to pray so much that the chains fall off of whatever the enemy has of you unbound quickly. Watch this. He said, rise up quickly, and his chains fell off from his hand. Verse number 8. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandal. So Peter's shoes was off. Peter was just there figuring that it was over. Can't get out of the situation that he in. But the church is praying for Peter. Peter is inside sleep. And an angel goes past what was blocking him in, comes in and smote him on his side. A light shines on him, told him, arise, gird up your loins, bind your sandals up. We gotta go. Because the church said that they want you, and we gotta do what they saying. Because the prayers of the righteous availeth much. Watch this. Gird thyself, bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, cast thy garments about thee and follow me. Cast his garments, watch this, on him and follow me. He was in prison. He was bound up in between two soldiers, chained up, with guards guarding the door. And an angel came past the guards, came into that situation that they were praying for, located Peter, smote him and tell him, get up and put your clothes on and put your shoes on and let's go. Watch this. Come on. He said, and follow me. The angel said, follow me. Let me help y'all out. The angel said, follow me, Peter. I'm going to show you how to get out of this situation because of the prayers of the righteous. Verse number 9. And he went out and followed him and wist not that it was true which was done by the angels. But he thought he saw a vision. Peter is sitting there thinking and moving and thinking he's in a vision. Man, I must be visualizing this happening because I thought it was the end of the road. He said, follow me. Peter thinks he sees a vision of him being following an angel, and this is reality. Because the church has been outside making prayers without seasoning. Peter was not to find his own way out of the prison. He was to follow. Come on, watch this. That's what's wrong with a lot of saints. They don't want to follow. They want to come up with their own way. You can't come up with your own way. He said, how can they hear without a preacher? How can he preach except he be sent? Come on, yes. And he went out and followed him and wist not that it was true, which was done by the angel, but he thought he saw a vision. Verse 10. And when they were past, guess this, the first and the second ward, they came unto an iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of his own accord and went out. It said it opened to them. Peter and the angel. It opened to them and they went out. Watch this. And passed on through one street. Peter is following an angel out of prison. And the people are praying at home without seasoning because they know we cannot stop praying for Peter until we see the manifestation of what we prayed for. Passed through the street and forthwith the angel departed from him. The angel got him to where he needed to be. I don't know who I'm talking to. The angel will get your stuff, your family, your friends, your finances, your health, your wealth. Ah, come on now, your vision. He will get it, your business. He will get it out of the hand of the enemy. He will get it from being bound up, and he will bring it out. Out of harm's way. Take it out of prison. Go through all of the wars. Exit out the gate. Go out the city with your business, with your finances, with your healing, with your deliverance, with your prayer requests, with your car, with your house that the enemy wants locked up. But if you keep praying, those prayers will release an angel to go in and get your house and break it free and bring it from being in bondage. Bring it from the enemy trying to tie it up. Bring it from what you thought when it could not happen. Bring it out. Watch this. The first and the second war, they came unto the iron gate that led it unto the city, which opened unto them of his own accord, and they went out and passed on through one street. And forthwith the angel departed from him. The angel only was on the assignment to get Peter out of harm's way and get him to a place he can handle himself, to locate the rest. See, you don't understand. Angels are designed to assist you. But when you pray, you got to have a prayer life. So while you're making prayer without seasoning, it's going to penetrate through the wall, through the gate, through the door, past the guards, all the way to the back of the prison, and wake Peter up and say it's time to go, and lead Peter from the back of the prison to the second part of the prison, to the first part of the prison, out unto the gate, out into the street, through the gate of the city. And then the angel said, I done done all I was supposed to do. Watch this. Watch this. Verse 11. And now Peter, and when Peter was come to himself, he said, now I know of a surety that the Lord have sent his angel to have delivered me out the hands of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. He said, they locked my stuff up, my job, they locked it up. They locked everything belonging to me up. But God said, if you make enough prayer, if your prayer is without seasoning, it's going to begin to activate your angel, and your angel going to be dispatched on an assignment to go and get what you prayed for. And some of you are not expecting what you prayed for. You prayed for healing one time, but you don't want to keep praying. But the Bible says you got to pray without seasoning. You got to keep praying. They is still praying for Peter. And the angel has went into the prison and delivered Peter outside of the city and departed from Peter. Watch this. And there's somebody on here right now. You need healing in your body. And God said, keep praying. Because the more you pray, the more serious you get. An angel gonna be dispatched on an assignment to locate your healing and bring your healing to you. Watch this now. So the Bible said when Peter came to himself, because when he left, he still had sleep in his eye. He was waking out of his sleep and he did not have time to gather his thoughts. He just was supposed to follow the light. So he followed the angel. And then when he came to himself outside of the city, he said, now I know for sure that the angel of God came in and delivered me. When Peter came to himself, he said, now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel, come on, and have delivered me out of the hands of Herod from all the expectations of the people of the Jews. 12. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. Come on. Everybody say praying. The Bible said, well, many will gather together praying. Remember, they were praying without seasoning. As they were praying without seasoning, the more they prayed, the more manifestation begins to happen. Because they kept praying until what they prayed for, they have to see it manifest. Some of you are praying, but you ain't watching. Some of you are watching, but you ain't praying. You got to pray and watch. And pray some more and watch again. Why? Because you need to see what you're praying for coming. No need to keep praying for it when God done gave it to you. So the Bible says right here, watch this. We had considered this thing. He came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. 13. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. So Peter is at the gate, knocking on the door. The people inside are still making prayers for Peter. Are y'all eating good? If you're eating good, say I'm eating good. If you're eating good, say I'm eating good. And as Peter knocked on the door, wait a minute. Peter is knocking on the door where the prayers are being made. Because when you pray without seasoning, your prayer is like a magnet. It's going to go and get what you're praying for and draw it to the door. So Peter hears them praying. And he begins to knock on the door. Boom. Some of you are praying for a job. Some of you are praying for healing. Some of you are praying for deliverance. Some of you are praying for family. But you don't stop praying because you have not seen it yet. You keep praying until what you pray comes knocking on the door. You praying for your husband, your wife. You keep praying until you see them come through the door. Y'all don't want to. Let's dig in it. We almost done, family. Let's dig in it. Watch this. Verse number 13. As Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken. Come on. You right about that, Sister K. Named Rhoda. Verse number 14. And when she knew Peter's voice, so that means it was a knock on the door. And Rhonda had to ask, who is it? And Peter said, it's me, Peter. Now catch this, Peter is outside the city, but the prayers drew Peter to the house that they were praying for. This is how you got to expect what you prayed for to come locating you. You're supposed to see what you prayed for. And if you don't see what you prayed for, you got to keep praying until you see what you prayed for. And when she knew, watch this, and when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. She was so ecstatic. She was so out of it. She was so shocked at what they prayed for that it was at the door that she didn't even open the door. She ran back where the people were praying. Verse 15, watch this. And they said unto her, thou art mad. But she was consistently affirming that it was Eve. So then said they, it is his angel. She said, no, I'm not mad. I know we in here praying, but what we praying for is knocking on the door. Now, the problem we have here is right here in verse number 15. And they said unto her, thou art mad. She said, listen, we praying, you done got mad. You saying that it's Peter knocking on the door. Peter's in prison. But they're not expecting what they prayed for. They're not expecting what they prayed for. So they told her that she had got mad, but she was constantly affirming that it was him. Then they said, it is his angel. Now I want to stop right here. So, Pete, if it's Peter's angel, why would they say that the angel at the door is Peter's angel? The only reason they saying the angel at the door is Peter's angel is because Peter's angel must look like Peter. So that means that in this biblical time that they knew for sure that there was angels and the angels looked like people they were assigned to. Say, my angels look like me. Write that down. Say, my angels look like me. Say, my angels look like me. Come on, we almost done. It's a reason they said that's Peter's angel. They said if it's anybody, it's Peter's angel. Why is it Peter's angel? Because apparently they have seen angels before. And the angels look like who they are assigned to. So my angels look like me. So my angels talk like me. So my angels can walk like me. But my angels do in the spirit what I can or cannot do in the flesh. The angels are part of the spirit realm. And it's angels that are assigned to you that are asleep because they don't have an assignment to do. So the people thinking that Peter angel is knocking on the door. They figuring that it's the angel of Peter knocking on the door. But you pray for Peter to be free. And you pray without seasoning. So now that you pray, you got to see what you prayed for. Watch this. They said, no, that ain't Peter. Even though we prayed for him, that ain't Peter. That's got to be Peter's angel. Watch this. It's right here. Thou art mad, did 15, but she constantly affirmed that it was Eve. So then said they, come on, it is his angel. So that means that Peter has an angel. If Peter has an angel, you got an angel or angels. The problem is they all sitting there doing nothing. Verse 16, but Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, you got to expect what you prayed for. They prayed for Peter, and Peter shows up against all odds. Peter shows up at the door knocking. The blessing that you prayed for is on the other side of the door. And some of you are so lazy, you don't want to get up and open the door. But my Bible tells me that Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man open up, I'll come in and I'll sup with him. Some people don't want to open the door, but they asking for something. But you got to get it on the other side of the door. Come on now. Come on. Hey, that joker said, I got too many doors that need to be open for my angels to be bored. Let's go to work. Your angels should be on an assignment. All right, Miss Crenshaw. Your angels should be on an assignment locating your money. Your angels should be on assignment going to get your car. Your angels should be on assignment going to get your kids. Your angels should be on assignment going to get your family out of bondage. Getting your crackheaded cousin off of the street. Getting that drunk alcoholic cousin of yours out. Getting that person in your family in homosexuality out of homosexuality. There should never be a cease in prayer because the Bible said pray without seasoning. And the people kept praying, but as they were praying, they weren't paying attention. They weren't watching. So when what they prayed for came, they said, it is not what we prayed for. This can't be it. But you got to expect what you prayed for. When you serving God, And I know that my Father, which art in heaven, hears me. Jesus, the Son of the living God, my Lord, he hears me when I pray. So it does not always blow my mind to the point like, I'm like, wow, he did it. I'm expecting it to happen. It blows my mind of my relationship with him. That when I pray, doors swing open. That when I pray, healing take place. That when I pray, miracles, signs and wonders come. That's what blows my mind. I'm infatuated with Jesus. He's a mind blower. That me, I can pray and he'll hear me. And I'll be on the other side of the door. People who have been with my ministry for a long time, they will tell you. It's a lot of things. But I'm telling you, if I ever need him, I could pray. And it happens. If I ever need him to come up for something right then and there, I can pray. I'm talking about, like, if I need him an emergency. I need him every day, but I'm talking about, like, Lord, ooh, Lord, I need this. And he'll manifest it. Period. I remember one time I was riding, I was working, and I looked, and I seen a beautiful washer and dryer. And I said, man, I like that. I said, I like that. I kept on riding, working. I said, I like that. The color and everything, I like it. But it was at one of those psychic's house, and I said, I'm not, no matter is it for sale, I'm not buying it, but I do like it. Later that week, a man that I know sent a picture on Facebook with the very same thing, and he wanted to sell it. Just what I asked for, he gave it to me. You see what Uncle Rita said? Yes, that's what I seen. Amen. Yes, believe him. I'm telling you. It's happening. I'm telling you. It's happening. I'm telling you, some of you are praying, but you won't get up and check the door. Because you want to pray it all the way through the door. You want to pray it all the way to the table. You want to pray it all the way in your hand. You want to pray it all the way in your bank account. But you don't want to get up and meet it. Rhonda has to go to the door. And then she hears a knock on the door, and it's Peter. And then she was so ecstatic, she goes back to tell the people what we praying for just showed up at the door. I'm speaking to somebody. The Lord said, you've been praying for it. And this time tomorrow is going to show up at the door. What you've been praying for will show up at the door. But faith without works is dead. If you pray and you're not watching to see what you're praying for, then what is the purpose of praying if I'm not going to be on a watch to see what I'm praying for? Some of you need healing. Some of you need deliverance. Some of you need your life to be turned around. Some of you need to get your mind back. Some of you need to get your script back. Some of you. But he said, it's on. It's at the door. You got that right, Brady. Now. Some of you prayed for it and God said, I got it at the door, but you won't get up off of your tail or do nothing and check. Expect what you prayed for. They praying for Peter. Peter gets out of prison. The angel delivers him and he is drawn all the way to where they're praying at. Why is Peter not drawn anywhere else? Why is Peter drawn to the very place that they're praying at? Because prayer is a magnet. Write that down. Prayer is a magnet. A magnet that will draw your blessings to you. But Peter continued knocking because you prayed for me. So I want you to know what you prayed for is at the door. Peter said, come on, let me in. Somebody been praying, let me in. They in there, can't believe, they arguing about who at the door instead of going to the door and getting what you prayed for. My prayer is a magnet. It draw in what I'm praying for. Watch this. But Peter continued knocking. And when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Yes, they gotta have a true connection. They were astonished. They were astonished. Because what they prayed for showed up at their door. My prayer is a magnet. And some of you getting ready. If you keep praying, if you keep believing, you getting ready to get a phone call. You getting ready to receive your healing. You getting ready to walk into the biggest blessing you have ever seen. If you willing to go past hearing the knock and go to the door and open the door. Watch this. But Peter continued to knock, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Watch this. I want y'all to pay attention. A few more minutes and we're going to go. I want y'all to pay attention. What happens? They are astonished. But true saints, when you pray, you should be able to see what you're praying for. If you have a true connection with God. If your connection is not true, then you're going to be astonished when you see, when you link up with people that pray, and when you link up with people that pray, and what they pray for come into manifestation, it's supposed to astonish you, not the one that prayed, because they know the connection. They're just in them like, man, God is amazing. They humble. They like, wow, glory to God. Because they looking like, man, God, you hear me. When I call, you hear me and you answer me. Watch this. Verse 17. But he beckoned unto them with his hands to hold their peace. He said, listen, be quiet, be quiet. Let me get in the house. This blessed, y'all pray for me. Let's not just celebrate at the door. Let me come in. Let me come in. Watch this. And declare to him, unto them, how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, go show these things unto James and to the brother. And he departed and went unto another place. Y'all see this? 17. He departed. He came only to show them that what you've been praying for, your prayers have been answered, so you can quit praying. Now I gotta go somewhere else. You got that right, Uncle Richard? Come on, you feel me? He said, now I just came, I just stopped by to let the church know that what y'all prayed for, here I am. Some of you been praying that you find a true leader that's gonna lead you in the path of righteousness. But when the true leader shows up, instead of you celebrating and following, wait a minute, I don't think this is it. Wait a minute, I'm going to go somewhere else. I got to figure it out. This what you prayed for. There is no question when you what you pray for shows up. How many people been praying to God to send somebody to lead them to him? Lead them the right way. How many people been praying for that? If you have, say I have. How many people been praying for that? If you have, say I have. If you've been praying for that, say I have. Come on. So when you pray and God said, okay, I heard your prayer. Now, I'm going to let him get on Facebook. I'm going to let what he say catch your attention. I'm going to let what he says begin to manifest, because I want you to know what you pray for. Your prayers have been answered. Now, when your prayers have been answered, you don't have to no longer pray for that to come. You already have it. Now you pray for that to be strengthened, and you be submissive enough to follow what you prayed for. Because apparently he gave you somebody that's going to lead you in the path of righteousness. In the midst of judgment, we still going to do right. We still going to be who God has called us to be. Why? Because so many people are falling by the wayside. When you pray for something, when you pray, God, send somebody. God, this church in a mess. God, these people ain't right. And God, send somebody. You got to stand up with the people that God sent. You don't fight against them. You fight with them. Watch this. The Bible said, but he beckoned unto them with his hands to hold their peace. And declared unto them now how the Lord had brought him out of prison. He said, listen. Come on. You feel what I'm saying? You understand, Uncle Richard. Right? You understand? See, when I see the manifest, I don't have to look no more for what I need. If God done signed it, now I just need to keep it going. I need to be submissive enough to follow, but I need to keep a prayer life to keep them covered, because if what they saying come to pass, I need them to stay pure. I need them, because when they speak, my business start booming. When they speak, blessings start manifestation. When they speak, healing take place. When they speak, deliverance take place. So I need to make sure that I keep them lifted up. Because if that mouthpiece has God ears, we see what we prayed for. Peter is telling them, listen, I'm only stopping by because I was led here, because you prayed for me. I just want you to see what you prayed for. Now I'm getting ready to go somewhere else. Isn't it something that they were making prayer, and this is the first place that Peter stops? Let me read it again so you will know for yourself. Verse 17. And he said, go show these things unto James and to the brother. And he departed and went to another place. Peter showed them, because they the one that was praying. And then Peter departs and goes to another place. Some of you, you already have a true man of God. You already have one. You don't have to look for another. You just got to be submissive enough. Yeah, you're right about that. You got to be submissive enough to follow the one that God has brought to you. And not try to be in front of them, but push them and to teach us, Moses, lead us the way, show us the way to go. Why? Why? Because if God, you prayed for it and God delivered it, then therefore you need to look for what you prayed for. And when you see what you prayed for, you thank God for the person that you sent. Because God, if it had not been, I could be still a scrape. I could have lost my mind. Is there anybody here that knows that they was in a situation and God saw a man of God, or they reached out to a true man of God, preferably myself? It's other people, but I'm only going to talk about me because I want to bring other people up on no lie. They reached out to a true man of God, and what they reached out to the man of God about, they began to see the manifestation. Everybody's manifestation may be different, but your persistence has to be the same. You got to stay in the race. You got to stay in the pace. You got to keep following. You got to keep seeking. You got to keep going with them. They say we need to pray. You need to be praying with them. Why? Because if your next move, your next level is locked up in their mouth, you ought to be praying, keeping them. Because I need him to release another word. We done had enough of not seeing what we praying for. It's time to expect what you prayed for. That's what you should be expecting. That's what you should be looking for. Come on. Yeah. I don't know about other leaderships. I just gotta, you know. But when God sees somebody, when God sends somebody, that's the way. Why, if God sent Jesus, why follow anybody else than the one he sent? A lot of people, they pray for something, then they get it. They don't want what they prayed for, because when you pray for a leader, he sent you a leader that wasn't going to allow you to slack up, wasn't going to allow you to fall short, was going to push you to your promise, was going to tell you we got to keep moving. It's not time to stop. You got to desire more of God. You got to keep going. Y'all see Brother John seeing manifestation instantly. You got to keep going. You got to keep pressing. You got to keep pushing. Why? Because it's another place that we have to be. And we cannot stop just with this. You got to come on, want more and more. Because if God did a blessing for you instantly, can you imagine where he's getting ready to take you to? Can you imagine what he has in store for you? Someone asked the question, are you expecting what you pray for? When you pray for something, you got to expect what you pray for. It may not come the way you want it. They say, Lord God, I want an easy preach. God, send me a leader. God, send you a leader. It ain't how you want it. They push you past what you thought was your limits. Come on. Can you only imagine what's to come? This is why it ain't about numbers. Jesus was only dealing with 12 that he taught in a small group. And then they went out and did demonstration and manifestation. You got to be hungry for this. The Bible says, him that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. False leadership with no manifestation is a waste. Now that's a word. I'm expecting it. Come on, I want everybody to put, I'm expecting it. Come on, I want everybody to put, I'm expecting what I prayed for. I'm expecting it to show up at the door. And when it knocks on the door, you have to open the door so it can come in. Peter only showed them that you can stop praying now. You can quit praying for me to be free, but keep praying that I go and be who God has called me to be. I am expecting what I prayed for. Peter only stops to show them that you can stop praying for me to be free. I'm free, but I need you to keep praying that I be who God has called me to be. That God take me higher. Because if God take Peter higher, the people that's with Peter going higher. More manifestation. Deeper manifestation. You have to be in an expectancy of what you pray for. That's why this is Shines Live. Expect the unexpected. God will interrupt your life. God will give you a mind-blowing miracle by tomorrow. Some of you will walk out of the door and get good news. People who belong with this ministry, they see a manifestation. Why? Because you can't have a leader that can't pray something off of you or can't help you get out of a hard spot into your next dimension. You have to be in an expectation. When you come to church, when you come online, you got to be expecting to receive the word of God. way that God is going to take us higher. Follow the leader and let's go lower in prayer. Let's pray more. Let's lay on our face more. Come on. Let's fast. Let's be on the watch. Let's do more. Too much is given, much is required. So well, I want to let all you know, keep your leaders, the real true leaders, keep them lifted up in prayer. I ain't going to say nothing about the ones that's not. Because if you know they're not, then you with them, you just as wrong as they is. Now watch this. And we getting ready to tone it down. Some of you, the stuff you need may be locked up in your leader's mouth. And if your leader speak over you and you never see what they spoke, that's not your leader. God will never give you a leader that does not have what you need inside of them. A woman, when she has a child and the baby is born, the woman has the milk for the child. The woman can nurture the child and get the child to another level. So I'm here to tell you, check your leader. And if what your leader is saying, you saying manifest, that's who you follow. You follow the manifestation and the presence of God. Let me say this, it's a must. If you don't know the difference between as a light and being a light, then you will be led astray. If you don't know the difference between the lion of the tribe of Judah and like a roaring lion, you will be led astray. Listen, there was a fight in heaven in the book of Revelation. And one third of the angels that was in heaven sided with the devil. This is where you got to know your leader. Because one third of the people, come on, Brady, you hear me? Hallelujah. One third of the devil, the angels, turned and followed the devil. That means two thirds of the angels stayed with God, but one third of the angels went with Lucifer, and Lucifer turned into Satan, and they went from angels to demons. So if in heaven, the enemy can convince one third of the angels to turn against God, what are you thinking is happening in some of these churches? The enemy is appearing as a light, but he's not a light. The enemy is appearing. Come on now. That's right, Buff. Okay. The enemy is appearing like a roaring lion, but he is not the lion from the tribe of Judah. So he is going to convince some people to follow no manifestation, to follow no deep revelation. He's going to convince some people to follow him to hell. There was angels in heaven. There were archangels, but there was an angel named Lucifer, and he was over the minister of music. And as he was over the minister of music, he liked the glory that God was getting, and he convinced one third of the angels to follow him to come up against God. And that's when they got kicked out of heaven and was sentenced to hell. Now, how in the world can you follow somebody that you never see manifestations happen? How in the world can you follow somebody that they praying, but we can't never see the manifestation of what we praying for? Ouch. Something is wrong. Because if you sick, you need a physician. And your pastor, or your prophet, or your apostle, or somebody over, you need to be able to pray. And something happens. He fooled one third of the angels. So many people are not paying attention. Come on, you right, but they are not paying attention. So what they do is they follow anything that is not pushing them to be better. They follow anything that's making them comfortable, but they don't follow what makes them uncomfortable. God is not being in your comfortness. God is being in your uncomfortable. You don't believe me? Ask Peter. Peter was on the boat. Peter said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. Jesus said, Peter, come. He told him, he said, come. When Peter began to come, he walked out on the water. He got out of his comfort zone and got into an uncomfortable place, but he walked on water. And some of you will not walk on water because you don't want to leave your comfort zone. It's time out for playing church. It's time to be the church. So listen to me, family. You got to know who God has placed over you. I want to help y'all. Let me look this up right quick. Isaiah, right quick. Let me look this up. Isaiah 45 and 11. Let me look this up for y'all. Yes, Isaiah 45 and 11. Write this down. Because I want to help y'all know who your leaders are. So you can follow the leader. Those of you who already know your leader, this ain't for you, but this for the people that saying, well, it might be, I might follow him. I don't know. I don't really know because I really don't want to stop smoking. I really don't want to stop drinking. I really don't want to stop fornicating. I really don't want to stop doing what I'm doing. So these are for the people that need to figure out who their leader is. But those of you that already know and already see the manifestation, you don't have to worry about that. Verse 45, Isaiah 45 and 11. Thus said the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, watch this, and his maker, asked me of the things to come concerning my son. Asked me of the things to come concerning my son. And concerning the work of my hands, commanded ye me. He said, listen, you see the work of his hands. Ask me, if that's my son. And if I tell you that's my son, you follow my son. Why? Because God sends his son to lead you. They were supposed to follow Jesus. Now Jesus done showed us the way. Now God is raising up sons of God that are going to lead the people in the path of righteousness. Isaiah 45 and 11. Write that down. Isaiah 45 and 11. Are y'all following me? Oh yeah, let me put this right here, y'all, so y'all can see. You helped me to quit smoke. You prayed over me. Amen. Isaiah 45 and 11. Write it down, family. We getting ready to go. Write it down. Write it down. There it is. Isaiah 45 and 11. So if this the work of God's hand, my people don't have to do this. They done see manifestation after manifestation after manifestation. At the manifestation, God has answered. But some of you, God is leading you here. And as God is leading you here, then guess what? You need to pray to Isaiah 45 and 11 and let's go. Because we don't have all day. We got a place to get you and we can't get you there while you being everywhere. The church was over in the house praying. Peter was in prison, but the church prayed so much that Peter got released from prison by an angel, and he showed up at the house to show them that what they prayed for has manifested. And some of you, God brought you here for a reason. And while you're here, you might as well be who God has called you to be. Because what you're doing now is not working. You following yourself, and that's like a dog chasing his own tail. You ain't getting nowhere. You got to be willing to submit up under somebody that knows the voice of God, that knows what the Spirit is saying to the church, so you will not be ignorant. Sheep can't lead themselves. But there is a shepherd that God is raising up to lead you in the path of righteousness. And if you want it bad enough, you'll say, God, I gave you the scripture to pray. When you pray, pray Isaiah 45 and 11. You can ask him about me, or you can ask him about your pastor. You should be able to ask him about anybody. And he said, thus said the Lord, the Holy One of Israel and his maker, ask me of the things to come concerning my sons. So if I'm a son and you ask him, he got to show you that I'm his son, right? And concerning the work of my hands commanded. He said, listen, the work that you see him doing. Now the people that's been with me, they see the doors open. Come on, they see the manifestation. This is not a call to get both people in the ministry, but I just want the people that he has for me. I don't want sheep that should be here over there, and sheep that's over there should be here. No. We got a place to be, and you got to have eyes so you can see what the Spirit is saying to the church. And some of you, your life is a merry-go-round. And it's time for you to get off of the merry-go-round and go onto another place. Every person, watch this. Every person that have seen the manifestation, every person that know God, watch this. Every person that know God has led them up under this ministry, say me. The people who say me, they don't have to pray and ask God, because God already done showed them a million times. We get ready to go. But just say me. Y'all see the me's. Why did they pay attention? Come on. Come on. Come on. This is no game. This ain't no gimmick. They would tell you. You see the people that say me, they would tell you the truth. No lie, no games, no gimmick. I gave you the scripture that you need to pray. And if you know this is what God is calling you, it's time to go up higher. It's time to go up higher. It's time to go up higher. You cannot stay outside of the box. You can't make it outside the box. You can't make it just wandering on your own. I'm telling you, God is raising up an army. And you better shape up, because we got an assignment. And God is getting ready to do what eyes have not seen nor ears have heard. Neither has it entered into the heart of man what God has in store. What God is getting ready to do. I'm telling you, your city ain't seen nothing yet. Your city ain't seen its best days yet. Yo, I'm talking about some true power. I'm talking about some true anointing. I'm talking about the true fire of God. I'm talking about today we was in service and we laid hands on a man. And he could not stay in his seat long. He had to go. And my God, deliverance took place, period. It's up to you. But you got to want it bad enough to submit to it and fall. Everybody life change. Everybody increase. Yes, I'm going to push you past your limit. But everybody under me increase. Wisdom, knowledge, understanding. I'm talking about for real, for real. I'm talking about they whole life shift. I'm talking no games, no gimmick. They're right, she's talking. I'm talking about for real, for real. I'm talking about a serious army. I'm talking about what the Bible is talking about doing. I'm talking about. Trust me. So it's up to you, family. Send the fire. We getting ready to pray. I gave you what you needed. You got to expect what you prayed for. But I'm telling you, over here is not no cookie cutter. Y'all seen Brother Brady and Sister K put up that strong meat earlier. It's strong meat. You cannot stay on milk but a certain period of time. I'm going to say this, signify it. A woman's body only produces milk for a certain period of time. You got it right, Joanna. For a certain period of time. And God has her body designed to shed the baby from getting the milk because it is done at that particular time. A baby is not supposed to be 8 years old still feeding off of the mother. He has to shift from milk to meat. And then when you get strong, you go from a hamburger to a steak. It's from meat to strong meat. And you got to chew it up. And you got to chew and chew and chew until you can swallow it. But you cannot want to remain the same. The people know that's with me. I'm going to push you to a whole nother level. And this is not no call for people who don't belong here. But I feel led tonight that there's some people that belong with this ministry. You're welcome. So they belong to this ministry. And there's a call for all the sheep that belong to this ministry. God is getting ready to draw them in. So don't wait. And you got to be at the back trying to get to the front. So them that have an ear, let them hear. Yeah, you're right. What the Spirit is saying to the church. Can't put a hamburger versus a steak. Totally different. You can either chew that hamburger or that steak. I'm going to get it in a minute. And then you can digest it. The word is a mystery. The whole word is a mystery. And what you pray for is knocking at the door. You go to the door. He said, the prophet at the door. The prophet at the door. You better get this steak. You better get this steak. I'm telling you. Glory be to the Lamb of God. Send the fire. We're going to pray. People know, listen, you got to expect what you prayed for. You can't get with somebody that's going to let you lay back, lay down, die, dry up, let you never tap into who God has called you to be, never push you past what you thought you knew about God, never push you to a whole nother level in God. I'm telling you. I'm telling you, some of you, you belong up under the leadership of SRH Ministry, where you belong. And it ain't to pacify you. And it ain't for you just to come and get blessings because all my people are blessed. But my people know the difference between as a light and being a light. They know the difference between wine that Jesus had and wine that the world gives. They know the difference between like a lion and the lion from the tribe of Judah. It's time to go higher. Send the fire, family. We're praying that every sheep that's lost come on home. Hallelujah. God is getting ready to take us to another place. And some of you got to get pushed unto your purpose. You know who you are. Hallelujah. Send the fire. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your revelation. We thank you for your manifestation. We thank you, Father, for each and every individual right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we asking that you allow blessings to begin to flow on your people. Father, every person that feels the tug, that feels the pull, that they belong up under this ministry, Father, give them a hunger and a desire. Father, they're getting ready to pray Isaiah 45:11, Father, the people that's trying to figure do they belong at this ministry. They're getting ready to pray, Father, and if they belong here, show them. Give them a desire to seek after your word. Give them a desire, Father, to come in and be who you have called them to be. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the ministry. We thank you for the word. We thank you for the revelation. We thank you for the manifestation. Father, in the name of Jesus, I speak over their life right now. What they prayed for is at the door. And Father, we thank you right now that blessings, manifestation, healing, deliverance, miracle signs and wonders is located them now. And let this week be a blessed week for them. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Come on, say amen. Come on, say amen, amen. Hallelujah. Y'all better come on in. Hallelujah. Come on, tell God thank you, say amen. Hallelujah. Listen, family, we're getting ready to go. But those of you that are truly connected, we'll be back on Tuesday and Wednesday. But those of you that want to get more connected, you got to reach out to the people that you've seen that said me. They know a deeper schedule of me. We got another thing going on. We go deeper than just where we at. But it has to be a hunger. It has to be a desire. And I'm telling you, and you'll see the manifestation of God. If you're ready to get off of that couch, if you're ready to get off of that stool of do nothing, if you're ready to work and see the manifestation of God in your life, and I'm talking about really love him, the blessing, we thank him for the blessing, but we love the blesser. Give us Jesus, everything else can wait. Hallelujah. So listen, those of you that are just catching the lives, we'll be back on Tuesday and Wednesday at 8 o'clock, Tuesday and Wednesday. At 8 o'clock, set your alarm. Remind yourself, you got to press for the word. You got to fight for the word. You got to push yourself to get in the word. You got out of the word, so you got to press your way back in the word. So you're going to have to keep reminding yourself. But remember, Tuesday and Wednesday at 8 p.m. Tuesday and Wednesday at 8 p.m. Listen, God bless each and every one of you. Listen, there's a blessing with your name on it. And God is releasing it. And it'll be at your door this week in Jesus' name. God bless you, family. We love you. We're praying with you. We're praying for you. God bless you. Shalom.